Hey, yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to OCCULTURE, where we create the Philosopher's Stone through the alchemy of meter and rhyme. I am your host, Ryan Peverly, the poet manipulating your mindscapes in free time with this audio invasion that is downright misdemeanor. Nah, scratch that. It's a goddamn felonious crime because we're violating your ear space and forcing open your third eye, and you better keep a lookout on your heart chakra neighborhood. We coming for that next because 528 hurts so good. Welcome to the show. You picked a hell of a time to hit the old download button because we've got a good one coming up with Danny Nemu, Reverend Danny Nemu, if you're in the market for reverendy things. Danny is the author of Neuro-Apocalypse, a book about how language shapes human consciousness and evolution. And that really is saying the least about it, because there's a ton of great content and insight in this book, and you're about to get an earful of it. So let's stimulate that temporal lobe with this extra celestial audio probe and cast this pod off deep into the heart and mind of the apocalypse. Enjoy. Danny Nemu, thanks for being here, man.
All right then, Ryan. Very good to be here. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, man. So we were talking a minute ago about your Twitter bio. I have a few words here that I think are going to encapsulate our entire conversation. Linguistics, cognition, anarchy, and revelation. We'll get to that in a minute. But before we do, talk a little bit about yourself. You know, I know you've been making rounds on some other podcasts recently, but for the audience that hasn't heard you or your story yet, you know, who is Danny Nemu? Are you a real reverend? And what is it about your journey that's led you to where you are now? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes a whole lot of sense. Am I real reverend? I'm realer than Lady Gaga as a lady and Prince Buster as a prince. I got ordained on the internet for $15, and we're going back a few years, we're going back about 20 years, and that was more money than it was today, than it is today. And I got ordained because I was living in Japan, and my job out there, one of my jobs, I had five jobs actually, but one of them was, there's a whole industry for white guys like me, because Jesus was a white guy, you know, to marry Japanese people in front of stained glass windows with, I can sing What a Friend You Have in Jesus in Japanese. And I used to kind of go through five couples a day sometimes. So that's where the reverend came from. And then I hung on to him. Well, I needed a pen name, really, because my day job at the time was a teacher. And I didn't want people, my students, looking me up and finding out about ayahuasca and anarchy and all the other things in my Twitter bio. So I kept this guy, Reverend Nemu, as a kind of, as a pen name, as a kind of a front, really, as well. You know, he can get away with stuff that I can't get away with. So am I real? Is pi real, the number? You know, that's a kind of eternal thing. It feels, it doesn't die. Reverend Nemu doesn't die. You know, Reverend Nemu won't get old. I might. But the rest of your question, what's my story is kind of, I guess the interesting part of it is I'm fascinated with the apocalypse, and I always have been fascinated with the apocalypse, at least since my teens, you know, and that fascination has changed over the years. And one day I was at university, and I had to write a dissertation, and my academic background is the history and philosophy of science and medicine. And I'd been smoking a little bit, and the Jehovah's Witnesses turned up at my door, and I just found them completely fascinating and utterly deluded. And so I read their colorful pamphlets, and just sat in awe of these people, and I just really got into them. And I started, the first thing that piqued my interest, because my main interest was medicine and different approaches to medicine then, and I knew that they didn't have blood transfusions, and that really fascinated me. And also even not having blood transfusion was a kind of mark of the saved, in a way, of that crew. And I thought that was really, really interesting, kind of technology as identity, or refusing technology identity. But then, kind of through studying them, I did my dissertation comparing them with American Puritan movements in the kind of 1600s, and looking at their views on the body and medicine and sex. And all of these people are apocalyptic, and I just got really fascinated with the idea of apocalyptic people and how new technologies could develop. So, for example, with this blood transfusion thing, there's doctors who've had to learn all kinds of different ways of treating Jehovah's Witnesses because they won't have blood transfusions. So they've kind of furthered medicine in certain directions. And then I started looking into, like, Francis Bacon, for example, who basically the father of the scientific method, and his apocalypticism and how that fed into his own advancement of science. And even Newton, you know, Newton wrote 4,500 pages on the Book of Daniel and the Book of Revelation. He was completely obsessed with the apocalypse. In fact, he even had an anagram of his name, Isaacus Newtonus, which he kind of resolved to say the one chosen by God in Latin. You know, a very, very interesting character. So all of these really, really, all these people who advanced science and advanced philosophy in such a big way, not all of them, but a lot of them were apocalyptic. And then I started getting to the scripture side of it as well, and looking at what the apocalypse, what the end, kind of dividing the end of the world and the apocalypse, because they're quite different things. Both of them interesting. But yeah, the apocalypse from the Greek, apa, away, and kalyptin, which means a veil. So the lifting of the veil. And that's kind of my more mature current perspective on the apocalypse. I'm sure it'll change again. But what is it that we see? What is it that we miss? What makes us miss certain things? So, for example, we mentioned linguistics there in the bio you just mentioned. So I'm quite into languages. When I was in Japan, I learned Japanese. And Japanese construct the universe completely different in their own minds. Their culture is completely different, but also the way they perceive things. We can probably get onto that in a bit, but psychology of perception is totally different. And when they're studied, they remember different things, they see different things, all manner of things. So I was interested in the various different veils, if you like, and how we can penetrate them. So one of those is linguistics, also neurobiology, what's going on in your head, you know, when you focus on something, when you miss another thing, and so on and so forth. And then obviously psychedelics, which is another whole other kind of angle into the unveiling, the revealing insights on psychedelics. You know, we tend to think of psychedelics often as they're called hallucinogens, which means something that shows you something which isn't there. But quite often psychedelics show you something which actually is there and you just hadn't noticed it before.
So a couple things in there. You know, you're talking about Jehovah's Witnesses. I haven't had any visits from them recently, but I get visited every so often by some Mormon missionaries. They obviously do similar things. They come to your door, they want to hand you a pamphlet, they want to convert you to their lifestyle and worldview. But similar to what you said about it, I have let them into my house, and I have sat on the couch with them, and I have chatted with them for hours because of the same reason. I find them so fascinating. There's something about their cognition, their neurobiology, that I don't quite understand, because they're in a cult, but they don't realize it.
Well, so are all of us, really. You know, it was Black Friday the other day, and the whole world went completely mad for it. You know, if that's not a religious frenzy, then what is? You know, a cult, and a cult rather than the occult. A cult is a shared set of beliefs practiced by a certain group of people. So, yeah, Mormons are fascinating because they reflect us, you know. They've got loads of wives as well, which is also quite interesting. I met some of them they're quite big in Japan as well. They hang out at the stations in their ties, and they offer free English lessons to people in order that if they'll come along to their meetings. I remember meeting some, actually. It was just after the episode of South Park when the Mormons were in the first time they were in South Park, before the Book of Mormon and all that. Right. And I said, I wanted to get them back to my flat and to watch it, but they weren't allowed to watch TV, and they weren't allowed to date, and there was all this kind of stuff they weren't really allowed to do, which is incredible, you know. They were like young foreign men in Japan, surrounded by such exotic beauty, and I'm not just talking about the women, but just the entire culture, this mental spaces that they could move into, and they managed to take their whole cosmology with them and keep it intact where they were. It was a real feat of, what's the word? I don't want to say indoctrination. Like, it shows the power of the cosmology to those people, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I don't know about the TV thing now, because I made a Seinfeld reference one time when they were here, and they got it. They knew what I was talking about. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if they'd watched that show or not, but
I think it's when they're missionaries. They have particular kind of, I think they have to, I don't know too much about it, but I think they've got to do a particular kind of missionary tour, and there's certain things they can't do during that thing. And I don't think they're banned from TV for their whole lives. But what do you talk about with them?
Life, I guess. I mean, obviously the first couple times they were here, it was big on their belief system, their cosmology, trying to understand that, which I still don't quite get it, but beyond that, like, once they kind of learned that I wasn't into it, they just sort of just stopped by to chat. Like, I don't know if they found me fascinating or not, but they would just come by, they'd ask me how I was doing, you know, we'd talk about work and what books I was reading and what the books were about. So I think they found my cosmology interesting, but they haven't been by for probably 8 or 10 months, and I don't necessarily think they'll come back, but...
I think you missed your chance, man.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, it was probably a good 6 or 8 visits that they made here, and but after the course of, you know, like... that amount of time, which was over the course of probably 3 or 4 years. I just, they know that I'm not falling for it, so just stop wasting their time. Back to the apocalypse real quick. Do you think that we have underwent a collective apocalypse, or is that process more individual?
That's a brilliant question. I think both. I think fundamentally, apocalypse means discovery. Discover, right? That's one of the cognates. Disclosure as well. Revelation. As in vellum means a veil and rare away again. So when you notice something, it's an apocalypse, you know, when so it can be an angel peeping, you know, through the clouds, or it can be a discovery in science. And so an individual makes a discovery in science, right? The given example is Tesla. Now, Tesla was walking along in Budapest, Central Park in Budapest, with his friend, reciting poetry one day, and he was frozen to the spot by a vision of a machine in the air. And it turned out to be the AC motor, the alternating current motor. So when he got back to his workplace, he made it. And like all of his inventions, and the guy took about 500-600 patents, he'd never made a blueprint. He never made a calculation. He used to lie on his couch and just go off on a journey. And he used to describe going across all this kind of scenery. And then eventually he'd come to a machine, or the AND gate, or the Tesla coil, and all this kind of incredible stuff, which was very much personally his gift to the world through his genius. And genius being interesting as well, because the Roman conception of a genius was a specific spirit to whom you sacrificed on your birthday. And that was the particular spirit who was pictured with a plate, who would give you these ideas, these insights, right? So yeah, he had a personal apocalypse, but the result of his endeavors was very literally turning on the light. You know, that's one of the things he did, in fact, was he worked on electric lights. So yeah, it does have a knock-on effect in society. Or another example would be Galileo, who had the insight to place the sun at the center of the solar system. And he was building on the idea of, well, it was relativity, basically, the idea that things aren't in absolute places, like the Aristotelian universe is absolute, you know, this Earth is at the center, and that's where it is. Now, he said, no, it's not. He said, it's relative. It kind of depends where you start, right? So the whole, that has a whole series of continuing effects on, which ends up today in kind of moral relativity, for example. Or, you know, if you look at comparative religion or comparative medicine, for example, you know, the idea that the other guy has got some ideas which might actually be correct kind of follows on fairly logically from the idea of relativity, right? So here's, and there was another apocalypse there as well, because he actually took a telescope and turned it to the sky, which very literally made something which was hidden, i.e. the moons of Jupiter, was revealed, right? So there's kind of, there's technological apocalypses, if you like, which can feed into individual apocalypses, but then he gave the telescope to the popes, not to the popes, to the clergymen at the time, and said, here, look through this. And they said, well, I'm not down with your strange machine. It must be an artifact. But it was also the telescope when some people were prepared to have that apocalypse that move things. And there's a whole other aspect to this as well, because, you know, it was about 30 years between the discovery, or not the discovery, the refinement of the telescope to make it into an astronomical device rather than a nautical device. And then it was only 30 years away that the microscope was also developed. So then you could start looking underneath your fingernails and looking at what's going on in the lungs. So again, a whole new scale opens up. And it wasn't very far away from when the New World was discovered as well, because you had the Italian and Spanish kind of voyages of discovery. So all of that happened in a very, quite a narrow band of history, really, if you look at it on a global scale. You had the Italian Renaissance, all these new ideas of, again, relativity, perspective, all that kind of stuff pops up in art, realism in art, non-figurative art, using the canvas as a window into other worlds and the idea of other worlds. It all kind of you know, there individuals discovered things, but it became part, kind of, I see it as kind of a wave which spread up through Italy from the 14th century, coming through into kind of, well, you had the Reformation, 1538 around then. I think that's the right date. And then you have, so the Reformation was another, you know, the Catholic Church, which was the perspective on things, was shown to be one perspective. And then there's another perspective, that's the kind of various Protestantisms that arose. So new philosophies, new anti-Aristotelian philosophies, which is another apocalypse, and a whole new way of thinking in that direction, discovery of the new world, eventually kind of getting as far as England. By this time, we're talking about 1600s, and 1666 was when Newton discovered two things in 1666. One of those was gravity, and the other one was calculus, right? So there you've got, gravity is the first theory which unites the very, very big and the very, very small, right? It's well, before that, physics was a collection of different bunches of laws that dealt with different areas. And this was the theory, the grand theory. And then you got calculus. You know, calculus kind of puts the world into motion. You can start talking about circular motion, all that kind of stuff. Now, Newton was a funny guy. He an alchemist like yourself, and he didn't want to reveal his secrets. So when he published on the movements of the planets, for example, which used calculus, he replaced his calculus with normal maths. And then Leibniz discovered something, basically discovered calculus about 10 years after him. And Newton completely flipped, had a paranoid breakdown. And you often see this, like, so we've mentioned, you know, is it a personal thing? Is it a collective thing? Well, it's a personal thing. But if, you know, if the guy's hiding it, it often will pop up somewhere else. So another example of that is Darwin. 1858, he published his On the Origin of the Species. I think that was his first book. But he'd been working on that for I think, decades, such that one of his son, when he met another man, when he met someone, another child, he said to him, what kind of lichen does your father work on? Because that's what he thought men did. He thought they kind of collected very small, you know, made very, very slow observations of animals. So this guy was working for decades with a theory which he just was scared to publish. So along comes, what's his name, William Alfred Wallace, who was in the Malay Peninsula. He was a friend of Darwin's, or a correspondent of Darwin's, and he used to send specimens as he went on his travels. He would discover, you know, a new butterfly or something and send them off to Darwin. And one day Darwin gets a package on his desk, and it's from this guy Wallace. Wallace had been he got malaria, basically, and for 3 days he was so ill that he couldn't write. But by the time he would finish being ill, he kind of got a download of descent through natural selection. And he wrote it all down and he sent it off to Darwin, really excited. I think that was 1857. And Darwin was horrified, you know, because he'd been working on this thing for decades and hadn't published. So he published in a hurry the next year. So kind of individual, kind of collective, but it also seems that sometimes ideas are kind of pushing from somewhere into a collective space as well, perhaps.
Yeah, man. Wow. So is this sort of what makes up your first book, Science Revealed? Is that sort of the theme that you've been talking about the last few minutes?
Yeah. So part of it is about revelation in science. Most of it is about revelation in science. So like I mentioned Tesla, I mentioned a couple of dudes, there's loads of them. The guy Pesky, the guy who came up with the protocols of cyberspace as well on psilocybin. There's a whole stack of people. Nietzsche was another one. There's an interesting guy whose book completely changed the face of the world. He wrote the first, basically, Thus Spoke Zarathustra is written in three parts, and he wrote the first part in, I think, 20 days when he was at his sickest ever. He had tuberculosis and he couldn't move from his bed, but he wrote this incredible thing. So again, often coming through extreme states of either illness or psychedelic states or hypnagogia, for example, people coming out of dreams. Ramanujan's an interesting one there. He's an Indian mathematician who used to come up with outrageously complicated theorems. He died young as well because he went to England and he couldn't eat the food because he was vegetarian. But he used to get his formula, which is still being worked through today, and they form kind of the basis of whole branches of maths and kind of, I don't understand math very well, but apparently it's involved in string theory and all that kind of stuff. So he said that they were whispered to him by his family goddess. And he also said, a formula means nothing to me unless it represents a thought in the mind of God, which is a rather beautiful line. Yes, all these characters from various epochs in the history of science who've come up with the ideas. But also, the other part of the apocalypse is the veil itself. So I'm looking at how those ideas encounter the institutions of science, what science does to limit research in certain areas. So looking at kind of gentleman by the name of Semmelweis, who was one of the first to realize that basically doctors messing around with corpses and then going to deliver babies resulted in the mothers dying. And it was massive numbers of women dying from childbed fever, such that they were terrified to go into the ward. And some women were having in his hospital, because there was a ward where medical students were working. They were also messing around with corpses. There was another ward where midwives were working, and they were terrified to go into the ward where the students were, because, you know, they were, you know, something like 30%, a ridiculous number of them were dying, and a lot of the mothers weren't coming out. So Semmelweis kind of noticed that the only thing different between these two things were that autopsies were happening in one. And anyway, his revelation was laughed at, the idea of action at a distance, which basically it was, you know, the idea that something you could take a disease from one place to another. You know, at the time, the idea of disease was it was an imbalance. So obviously you can't, how can you take an imbalance from one place to another? You can't. That's magic. That's action at a distance. So this guy got, you know, he got completely ridiculed. He introduced hygienic measures into his hospitals, and they reduced the death rate massively. But then he lost his university posts and he lost his job, basically, ended up turning to drinking, and, you know, the death rates went straight back up again after they stopped washing their hands. And he ended up in a mental asylum. He got kicked to death, the poor guy. He got beaten to death. So kind of look, you know, germ theory was discovered just towards the end of his life, but the theory wasn't there. So I'm looking at that, and also other more recent periods of science where something that's been discovered, or certainly data, threatens the model of science, and how the scientific institutions deal with that, what journals publish, how scientific controversies are resolved, and they tend to be resolved through completely unscientific means. It's kind of bullying, cutting off funds, for example. Yves Rocard's an interesting guy. He was a French physicist. He invented the atom bomb, the French atom bomb. So big shot French scientist, and he started working with water diviners, you know, the guys who hold rods, and was looking in kind of coherent domain theory in water. And he lost his grant as well, despite the amount of data that he had. So all that kind of jazz. And then it kind of goes a little bit further. It goes into the very idea of truth, one true truth, and looking into beginning to look into the Bible at where this idea of one true truth comes from, because it's certainly nothing to do with the Old Testament. It's very much a New Testament. And going beyond that, it's actually a linguistic idea. It's in Indo-European languages, in Greek and in English and in Latin, something either is or it isn't. And you can't, something isn't two things at once, which is not the case in, like, Japanese, for example. Japanese is much more vague. Hebrew is much more vague. But yeah, so beginning to look at that, but that's kind of more developed in the second book. So yeah, the first one is basically around science, discovery, and impediments to discovery.
Absolutely, man. Well, let's transition then into the second book. It's the one that you've most recently put out. It's called Neuro-Apocalypse. A pretty cool title. Give us a brief synopsis of what this book is about, and then we'll unpack some of the ideas in it.
It's quite a big book, that one. So I'm looking at the apocalypse again, looking at the unveiling, but this time we're looking at not in science, but in what goes on in your brain. So one of the early chapters is looking at the Japanese language and the English language. Like I mentioned before, I'll give you an example of that. If you show a video clip of an animation of fish moving around in a tank, the Japanese, and show it to the Japanese will normally say, it looks like an aquarium. Whereas if you show it to an American will normally say, there was a big fish, and then go on to tell you what the big fish was doing. Whereas Japanese will describe more background details and the relationships between the fish. And then what's really interesting is if you then stop the clip and you wait for a minute or two, and then you show them the fish, but you show them fish on different backgrounds, or you show a bunch of fish on different backgrounds from the original clip, and you say to the Japanese, were those backgrounds in the original clip? The Japanese takes longer to answer than the American, and also they make more mistakes. For an American, it doesn't make any difference at all statistically if you put the fish on the same background or a different background, but it does for a Japanese. So it seems that in whatever way, the Japanese mind codes the individual with the ground, with the figure in the ground, which is really, really interesting. And then you look at that in terms of their culture, and then you see again, you see, for example, in Japanese art, you don't have still life in Japanese art because stuff doesn't make sense in isolation. But you do have kind of suibokuga, for example, those charcoal paintings where you often have like a kind of quite a lonely traveller in high definition, and you've got softly rendered clouds and waterfalls all around him. You get it everywhere, like in Japanese drinking culture. You can't fill your own glass. You have to wait for someone else to fill your own glass because you're constantly related. The individual and the context is constantly related, yeah? So I'm looking at the culture there, but also how that relates to linguistics, because Japanese linguistics are kind of very, very different to English. And one example of that is, you know, if I want to eat a pizza, I'll say I, starting with the agent, and that agent is me. I want, there's the kind of what I want to eat. There's a couple of verbs, and then pizza comes at the end. Now, Japanese happens the other way around, right? So you start with pizza or... And then people look around and everyone else is going, hi, or they're going, you know, and they make it, they're kind of building into that collectively generated sentence. And all you've said is pizza. Pizza or tabe. Tabe means eat, but you haven't said the end of the sentence, which is where the grammar is, right? So I want to eat, I don't want to eat, I ate it yesterday, I shouldn't eat it, but I'd like to. You could say, let's eat, let's not eat. You know, all that kind of stuff can come at the end after you've already taken in a whole lot more input from everyone around. I doesn't even come into it. You know, Japanese sentences don't tend to say I. And also looking at things like ki, for example, the idea of ki, which is built into the Japanese language all over the place. You know, if you don't get on with someone, something to do with ki, ki ga awanai, for example, our ki didn't meet. Ki ni tsuku, which means, kiotsukete, which means pay attention, or ki ni sawaru, which means it kind of annoys me. Yeah, is it the ki was touched, right? So that's one of the chapters looking at the differences between Japanese and English and how that veils certain things and how that reveals certain things. And then going on to other stuff in your brain which affects how you interpret the world. So, for example, if you show a hill to a young person, a fit person, you say, what's the angle? They will normally underestimate it. Whereas if you show it to an old person or an unfit person, they will overestimate it. They'll say it's steeper than it is. If you show it to a young person who's got a big heavy bag on their back, then again, they'll overestimate it. So looking at how the world that we see, and not just see, how we hear, the things that we remember, the things that we projected, the future, basically how we construct the world and how it relates to what's going on in our heads in terms of what we're thinking about, what we're scared of. As a good example, if you have a gun pointed at you in a robbery, everybody always overestimates the size of the gun. And they also say that people who are nearby were further away. And also looking for solutions. So the example there would be when people are running out of a burning building, they tend to form a scrum at the front of the building and trample on each other. And you can ask them afterwards, why didn't you go out the side exit? It's like, oh, I didn't think of the side exit, because the bit of the brain that was working was the kind of primitive emotional mind, which is the bit which refers back to patterns rather than generates new solutions. So all the stuff that's going on in your head and how it relates to what you see, how it relates to what you miss, also going into autism, going to various different brain conditions, also conditions like when people are, you know, when there's a car crash and they have to tear the door off a car in order to get their child out of the car. That's another thing, because then again, there's this kind of an unveiling of strength that you didn't, that you wouldn't normally have. You can't normally tear the door off a car, but actually a friend of mine tore the door off a car when he was hit by a drunk driver to get his fiance out. So all of that jazz. And drugs in the Bible, of course.
That's a lot of jazz, and there's a lot of drugs in the Bible for sure. But, you know, I want to go back to the idea of ki, because that is something that I think, that's one particular passage in the book that really fascinated me, because you're talking about it in terms of the architecture of language, which you touched on. You've explained, you know, that the Japanese architecture of language is different than how we structure language in English-speaking countries. But I was curious about that idea of ki, because that is something you hear in more of like an energetic sense. So I was curious, that obviously that idea of ki is pervasive then in Japanese culture, right? And it does sort of reflect that in the way they speak to each other.
Yeah, and not just that, it's also how they interact with each other. So I remember when I left Japan, I was really quite alarmed at how selfish people outside of Japan were. Back in England, like, and when I came back, I went to live in Brazil for a bit, and then I came back, and by that time I had two babies. And I remember trying to get on a bus one time with two babies in a double pushchair, and just being totally disgusted by the fact that the whole bus didn't rearrange itself in order to make space for me, because of course in Japan that's what they would do, and that's what I was exposed to when I left uni. And that was my introduction to the working world, to society, was amongst Japanese people. So this idea of ki, right? Ki is another agent, and it's a dispersal agent. So like I say, if I'm talking about I want pizza, it starts with I. Japanese pizza or tabetai, pizza. Or makes it into the object, and then it means want to eat, but it doesn't say I want to eat. necessarily. It can mean we want to eat, or, you know, pizza is want to eatable, if you like, be one way of looking at it. So we've got this, we begin with a big agent. Now, there's this, we don't have this agent of key. We do talk about key, but it kind of tends to get kind of abstracted into some kind of a mystical concept or some kind of spiritual concept in a way. But key is just basic part of the language. So there's a list here. Ki o tsukete means to apply key, literally, and it means to take care. Ki ga tsuita, ki arrived, I noticed. Ki ni sawaru, something touches the key, it's annoying. Ki ni naru, that's an interesting one. Ki ni naru. Naru means to become. So to become ki, or ki becomes, that means I'm interested by something. Ki ga awanai, awa means meet. Awanai means doesn't meet. The ki doesn't meet. So if I don't get on with someone, it's ki ga awanai. It's not like I didn't like him, it's the thing between us didn't generate, you know. And then you've got, I mean, genki, like that means how you doing, or means a healthy genki, original key, right? So it's super interesting, and it's kind of, I find it fascinating the way that it influences Japanese science, because, like, for example, Western scientists, Occidental scientists, tend to be very good at isolating individual aspects and analyzing cause and effect regarding those particular things, right? Which is how general normal science does is done in the journals. That's the kind of stuff that gets published in the journal. So if you look at the amount of Nobel prizes won in the States, it's like 40 times as many as they are there's one in Japan, right? Because science really likes this very focused gaze. If you look at what Japanese scientists have discovered, it was Japanese primatologists, for example, who noticed that chimpanzee troops have really, really complicated relationships between generations and amongst everyone, whereas Western scientists had noticed the mother and child bond, then really focused on anything else, didn't even realize it was there, really. So back to the kind of, there's a big fish and this is what the fish is doing, rather than looking at the background, noticing what's going on in the background, right? And if you look at some of the research on slime molds, for example, slime molds are these fantastic little single-celled creatures which, when the environmental conditions require it, they form into a slug, or they form into a kind of mushroom thing which produces spores. And it's a kind of, it wasn't really looked at by Western scientists, or not in the same with the same sophistication that Japanese scientists did. So what the Japanese did, which is amazing, was they put this stuff into mazes, for example, and established that a single cell thing could collectively find its way through a maze, right? And remember its way through a maze. They put blobs of slime molds, or they put rather bits of food at the on a map of the Tokyo subway system at the stations, and saw how the slime mold managed to connect up the stations. And they found that slime mold made a very quickly, in like a space of hours, I think it was, made the connections that were more efficient than the Japanese subway had actually been made. So it's an astonishing degree of intelligence. And we kind of imagine intelligence as being something local to our brains. And this comes back to this idea of I, you know. Whereas if you have this idea of ki, which is a more disembodied intelligence which is in the meeting of things, then it makes sense to kind of look at how slime molds come together to form slugs, and how they can understand space, how they can understand time, for example. Like, it was Japanese scientists that changed the environment once every hour and noticed that slime molds could preempt that, and a few minutes before the hour they started producing different, I can't remember exactly what it was, producing different enzymes or basically preparing to react to the changes in the environment. Yeah, key. Really, really, it's weird, isn't it? And we've got this other idea. The other idea, you know, if it's raining, you know, we say it's raining. And you think, well, what's it? You know, if it's cold, what's cold, right? Japanese don't say that. If it's cold in Japan, you say samui desu. Coldness exists. Coldness exists. And it's not really sure whether I'm cold or you're cold or the room's cold or whatever. That gets established in the course of conversation, because just like ki exists, just like there's this thing outside of us, which is something, they have this other agent. You see what I mean?
No, it makes sense. You know, like, what is raining? I don't know. The sky? Like, why wouldn't you just say, the sky is raining? It makes sense. So
mm-hmm. In Hebrew, it's Yored Geshem, which means rain falls. So in Hebrew, the agent is rain itself, right? Mm-hmm. In Japanese, the agent is not specified. In English, it's this kind of cosmic it. Which kind of really is interesting when you start looking at scripture, because in Indo-European scripture, so we're talking about Greek and English, you have this massive mega god, this omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, monotheon, it, this massive it. And you also have its enemy, which is, you know, oh, it's awful, isn't it? You know, the weather's terrible. And you've got, you have this, this the devil, basically, the devil, which is Satan, which is the snake, which is that liar, as it says in Revelations. Hebrew theology is so much more complicated. And there's many, many more agents. So, you know, in Hebrew, rain falls, and it's the rain that's the agent. In if you're cold, it's cold to me. Carly, it's me that's cold. I'm the agent there. So in Hebrew, in Old Testament theology, you've got a whole bunch of different God names. They behave completely differently. They have totally different agendas. They argue with each other. They tell different. They say different things. One of them says, El Shaddai says to Abraham, go and sacrifice your son. And then the spirit, the angel of Yahweh says, don't sacrifice your son. And then Abraham goes, oh, okay. And he works out what he's going to do. So there's a whole lot more agent going on. And then in Japanese, it's completely different again. Like their agent is much more obscure in a way. The Tao, if you look at Chinese, for example, which is constructed quite similarly, the Tao which can be named is not the original Tao, or it's not the true Tao. And then it's the thing which is not there is the thing which moves things, right? So I'm really interested in that as well, coming back to the idea of what is revealed in terms of the motive agent of the universe, what's behind the veil. It's completely different according to how you construct the language or how your language is constructed in order to look at it.
Yeah, and you know, that's a good lead into what I wanted to talk about next. And I'm going to talk about perception and memory, because these are things that I guess we think that they're subjective, but... Well, let me back up. So you have a couple of good quotes here that I want to throw out before we talk about that. But the first one, the picture we see is modified by the stories in our heads. The nervous system finds what it expects to find. And you're writing about yourself here. I was expecting treachery and found it everywhere, but no brain is free of expectations. Another good quote, each storyteller hears and narrates from their own perspective. So I'm curious if you think that, is cognition in a way, is it flawed because it is subjective?
It only exists because it's subjective, unless, well, that's really interesting. That's a really interesting point, right? Because you think about the Logos. Heraclitus talks about the Logos, and he says men believe, I can't remember the exact quote, but he says something along the lines of men think that they have their own understanding, their own Logos is the kind of ordering principle of the universe, and it's also the ordering principle of individuals. It means the word.
Well, I was going to say, is that where the word logic comes from?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, and that's what it is, logic, you know, my logic, your logic. Aristotelian logic, whatever. So he says that men think that they have a certain logos, they have a certain mind, but actually they're wrong, and it's from a universal mind. I think that's, yeah, so something has to be understood from a perspective. We can only see from a perspective, I suppose. So we can only cogitate from a perspective. In order to understand something, though, you have to kind of go around the perspectives, which is actually the story of Jericho. You know, the army go round, they go round it seven times, they look at the city from every angle, and they blast the trumpet, they make the noise, and all the walls fall down straight away, right? So when you've understood every perspective, then you can, then the walls fall down, then the apocalypse happens. The veil is smashed down. But no, I don't think it's flawed. I mean, it brings up something else, actually. Steve DeChazer, who is kind of one of the inventors of solution-focused therapy, I'm a hypnotherapist, that's my day job, he talks about the fact that the language is only useful because it's imperfect, right? So if what I wanted to say... If I wanted to say something to you and I could encapsulate it absolutely perfectly in language, there would be no answer because you'd already understand exactly what I was to say. So we couldn't have a conversation, you know? We couldn't have two separate viewpoints. So, yeah, it's a really good question. It's such a good question, I can't even give it a full answer. But no, I don't think it's flawed. I think it's just the nature of thought, you know?
Sure. Well, I'm going to ask a similar question then about memory, and I want to read another quote. You wrote that size and scale are stretched by our fears, our expectations, and our desires, and the distorted, keyword, and the distorted impressions are stored faithfully in memory. So that makes me wonder then, is the brain's memory system inherently flawed if we're only storing distorted impressions?
Well, yeah, again, interesting, isn't it? It's, we forget, selectively forget stuff, right? So, for example, if I'm giving a police report about something that happened, I'm not going to comment on what sauce I was eating on my chips at the time, right? And it's kind of the same with your memory. You remember stuff that's important to you and you forget stuff that's not important to you. So I'll give an example, which I gave in the book. You know, I knew a guy who could rattle off the World Cup players and scorers from every final and semi-final and quarter-final since the 1970s. And obviously that was very important information to him. I mean, I could tell you what year certain comets passed in the 1600s, because I'm fascinated by the apocalypse, and that's what sticks in my head, and that's useful to me. I don't know if it is actually useful to me. Kind of destroyed any hope of me having a career. But anyway, if for whatever reason I seem to remember stuff about the apocalypse in great deal. And, you know, my little cousin who's fascinated, or my little nephew who's fascinated by cars, he knows everything about cars. You know, if I get into a car and I go somewhere, get a lift somewhere, I can't even remember what color it is when I have to go and find it again, because I'm just not interested in cars. So we selectively remember stuff that we think is important to us, and generally is important to us. You know, it's quite important that a doctor knows where the different nerves go, where the different veins are. It's not particularly important to me, right? More important to me that I know what different plants do, because I approach health from a different perspective, right? And also we remember stuff that makes us feel good. So if people ask to estimate how much they used to earn, they say more. How much they drank in previous years, they say less. Or how much they gave to charity, they say more, you know. So we kind of remember, the bit of our brain which remembers is the same bit of our brain which imagines the future. So every time you're remembering something, you're actually remembering the last time you remembered it. That's why it's called remember, you know, remember, as in something that's dismembered, you remember it, you put it back together, right? So it's not kind of stored in an encyclopedia somewhere in your brain, you know. For most people, some autists, it does seem to be a little bit more like that. But, you know, we're not computers, you know. So computers are really, really good at remembering things like 4721369998 4. What, you know, we can't remember that. We remember what's important to us. We categorize in order to remember. We remember things in sets, and we remember relationships, relational stuff. And again, as a hypnotherapist, you know, it's quite important for me to, like, I had a client just the other day. She needed to forget something, basically. She'd been grieving over a lost love for the last 6 years, and it was all mixed up with her father got killed at the same time as this happened, her brother got into heroin, all this stuff went horribly wrong, you know. As a hypnotist, I can make people forget their names. If you give me 5 minutes with someone and they're up for it, they're up for experiencing what their brains can do, I can ask, I could use someone called Anna, for example, made her forget her name and asked her what her name was. She's like, oh, she was Jennifer, right? You know, I can make someone forget the number 3, so they'll count their fingers and it'll be 1, 2, 4, 5, 6. God, I've got 11 fingers, you know. It's useful for us to remember. If you remembered every horrific thing that ever happened to us, you know, imagine remembering all the tantrums that you had as a child, or every time that, you know, your ice cream fell off the cone or something like that. Problem is, then we have different types of memory again. So, like one of my other clients, she was a needle phobic. So when she was a little girl, she stood on the carpet, and the carpet had a needle in it, and the needle went into her foot, and then her mum completely freaked out, and there would have been a cortisol spike in her brain. My friend's brain, or my client's brain, which got the needle attached to cortisol spike, attached to terror. So when she got diagnosed as a diabetic, this was very, very problematic for her, because she couldn't go and inject her insulin. So we did a bit of work together. We did 3 sessions together, and I made her kind of unhook that thing, so change the nature of the memory. So, but generally, you know, fear, panic response. It's good that you panic when you encounter someone who's abusive. I mean, that's the correct response to someone. You go into kind of fight or flight mode. But we kind of, you know, we've got to navigate a dangerous world, and yeah, it can leave us traumatized in many ways.
Well, you said that we remember things that make us feel good. So I'm curious. I'm sure that you're aware of the theory that the heart also stores memories in addition to the brain, right?
Mm.
So I guess, first of all, what do you make of that theory? Do you buy that? Do you see any evidence for that?
Yeah, I mean, there's examples of people who had heart transplants and then suddenly started to like foods that they didn't like before, or started to call people by names that they hadn't used before. And then there's a couple of cases of people who go back to the family of the donor and discovered that it was a food that the donor had really liked. Yeah, so there's very good evidence of that. And funnily enough, in Japanese, it's kokoro, that is this the heart, which is kind of more like the brain. The brain is the thinking is done not so much in considered the brain that does the thinking. It's more the heart. So that idea of neurons, also in the gut, you know, it's neurons in the gut as well. It's just kind of all over the body.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, so if the heart stores memories, and then it obviously also can perceive things as well. So how does that, or does it, change the way that we define cognition then? Do we have to think of cognition in more of a, maybe a complete bodily system, as opposed to it just being in the brain?
Yeah, that's really interesting. If you look at If you look at Gabor Mate's work, for example, interesting dude. He was inviting a ayahuasca shaman to work with addicts in Canada. He talks about the connection between sadness and disease, basically. Now, if you're unhappy, your immune system stops working the same way it normally does. If you're on fight or flight mode, if your sympathetic nervous system has put you into freeze, fight, flight mode, then things stop happening. Like, for example, your digestion slows down or it doesn't work so well, so people get end up with IBS and stuff like that. Or your production of antibodies isn't working because your body's preparing to run away, right? So people get ill more often. People's hair starts falling out when they're really, really panicked. So, yeah, absolutely. Whatever you're thinking about affects your entire body. Not just that, it affects your entire family. It affects your entire community, in fact, you know, because that stuff is not localized to a particular body. You see it passing down through generations. You see stuff in, Holocaust survivors, for example. You see epigenetic effects in their grandchildren are still kind of suffering the trauma of that. And again, you look at the results of slavery as well, you know, that hundreds of years on. So, yeah, the division between the brain, the mind and the body is another interesting. It's another veil which is coming down. And that's how we advance in terms of knowledge, is when we break down veils.
Yeah, I actually read a book a couple years ago. I don't know if you've heard of it, but it's called The Mind-Gut Connection. And it's talking about how that gut microbiome is so important in terms of like mental health, that you can trace a lot of mental illness back to your gut bacteria and how, I guess you would say, it's just unbalanced and there's not enough diversity there. So it causes these mental, or what we call mental illnesses.
Yeah, I mean, that's really interesting. And people talk about the bilious temperament. Well, back in the day, it was about the bilious temperament, which refers to bile. And bile is what you use to digest your food. You know, Ayurveda, an Ayurvedic consultation begins with someone checking your pulse, three aspects of your pulse, and then asking you how your stool was. You know, did you go to the toilet in the morning? What was the consistency of your poo? That kind of stuff. And they can, you know, there's Ayurvedic psychology, all kinds of stuff. But yeah, a lot of it goes, I think pretty much all of it, if I understand it correctly, goes back to this, again, it's a form of alchemy, actually, how the body digests food and how that produces different doshas, how that produces a series of fluids. So a whole bunch of food makes blood, and a whole bunch of blood makes lymph, and it kind of goes up and up and up and more refined until you get up to bindu, which is kind of sexual fluids. That's the most refined of all of them. And again, you know, Wilhelm Reich was all about this. You know, his diagnosis of fascism generally and societal ills, or fascism specifically and societal ills generally, was due to repressed and ill-used sexual energy or gone.
Yeah, I love Reich's work, and I didn't even think about him as I was reading through your book and this stuff, but that does sort of apply what we're talking about here.
Yeah, then there's another dude who died in custody.
Yeah,
you get a bit too close to the wrong revelation and you end up getting beaten to death in a cell.
Yeah, I shouldn't be laughing about that, but yeah, you're absolutely right. You pose the question in the book that I want to pose back to you. It's very simple, and I think it'll tie up this discussion here about cognition and a little bit about linguistics too. But the question you posed was, is cognition limited by linguistics? So I would ask you for just a yes or no answer, but I don't think it's that simple.
Did I ask that question?
You wrote that in the book, yeah.
Is cognition... Say again?
Is cognition limited by linguistics?
Yeah, it depends how you define cognition, which is also an aspect of linguistics. I mean, there's the problem. By the nature of definition, definis, you establish the edge of something. So if we're talking about cognition and what goes on in your head, in an individual's head, then yeah. But if, I don't know, can you collectively... cogitate, you know, can two people get together, is could a discussion be a kind of shared aspect of cognition? What if you speak three languages? You know, what if you speak no language? If somebody who doesn't have language at all, like some of the really severe autists, for example, who they don't manage to do language, but they can, like, there's this one guy who he's a weaver and he weaves a fantastically complex mathematical formula to his weaving. Stuff completely, completely beyond the understanding of people who don't have that gift. So that's a form of cognition, but yeah, certainly a very different cognition. So I think to answer my question, which I foolishly posed and didn't expect to have posed back to me, one's cognition is limited by one's linguistics, yes, to a degree, but learning more languages and having more far out experiences that go beyond language, like heavy doses of psychedelics, for example, definitely broaden the amount of cogitating we can do. And then maybe we get closer to the more general cosmic logos rather than our individual logos. It does feel like that sometimes. You know?
But what about that? I was going to say, what about that more, you know, subconscious level, that subcognitive level where, you know, things like archetypes and symbols really speak to you? I mean, you could have a more diverse understanding of the world, for example, just from seeing things and not necessarily being spoken to verbally.
Yeah, again, it's kind of keying back into my day job, you know. Like I had this client yesterday, did I mention her before, but she got dizzy whenever she went in the sea. This was the same one whose dad got killed and all that kind of stuff. And I gave her a yes set, which is something that hypnotherapists do. And I said it like this. Basically, I gave her a series of questions which she had to say yes to, or a series of statements which she had to say yes to, in order to kind of get around her conscious cognition into the unconscious. Because I wanted her to agree with something which she didn't actually agree with, or at least her consciously she didn't agree with. So I said something along the lines of, you've come to see me even though you know that it makes you feel dizzy to be hypnotized. You're making these efforts. You're sitting there in that chair. Obviously, she's going to agree with all those kind of things. You know that this thing needs to be dealt with, and you know that there's a part of you which can deal with it. Now, that last thing was my idea, but I stuck it into a yes set in order to slip it past the conscious mind. So I think it's the linguistics, right, which is, when we talk about putting together a sentence, we're talking about prefrontal cortex. We're talking about the left prefrontal cortex, which does the kind of grammatical bit, and that's the newest part of the brain, basically. So, you know, animals understand symbols, they understand emotions, they understand what they can and can't do, even though they don't have the linguistics. And in fact, that's kind of where our genius comes from. You know, it might be clothed in word and certain complexes of symbols, but it bubbles up from somewhere else. And the conscious mind can hold, it said, 7 plus or minus 2 bits of information at a time, whereas the unconscious mind is doing, you know, it's adjusting your balance, it's growing your hair, it's governing what kinds of enzymes, hundreds of different enzymes are being produced in your liver. It's doing millions of things all the time, you know, completely unthanked. You know, you don't give it a second thought. In fact, when you do think about it, it's when it's gone wrong, when you've got a neurosis or a psychosis or something like that. So yeah, definitely. When an idea pops into our heads, like I've talked about with this revelation, like you talk about Tesla or that kind of thing, it may well be that kind of combination and recombination of code, of ideation, of symbol has been happening in the background. Again, we're talking about an alchemical process, you know, making fluid the fix, making fix the fluid. And then suddenly you hit gold and it pops into the conscious mind. And it's a little bit analogous to the way that the antibody production works, because there in the depth of the unconscious, your unconscious is commanding the production of antibodies. And it's code. It's lots and lots of different configurations of cells. And then sooner or later, one will encounter an antigen, and it's the right shape to deal with that antigen, and it will reproduce on a massive scale that particular one, and then you get inflammation and you get response to disease, but you wouldn't have even noticed until the inflammation happened. So the conscious, you know, it can kind of catch up, or it can make sense of, very literally make sense of the genius which keeps on throwing up ideation from the unconscious, whether that's in our dreams, whether that's in insights, whether that's in hypnagogia, or whether that's after, whether that's in a, you know, when you had a disease or something like that. So yeah, I would say absolutely. There's definitely intelligence. I mean, I'd look at it another way. You know, if somebody commits a murder, and because they're so drunk and they can't remember anything, it's not, they can't go to court and say, actually, it wasn't me who committed the murder. It was my unconscious. It wasn't me thinking. Of course it was you, man. It just wasn't you. It wasn't a part of you that you've recognized and you're prepared to take responsibility for. actually keys into something else, you know, while I'm on a roll. There was this kind of negation of free will, said to be a negation of free will, which was it was an experiment where people were asked basically to touch a button at a certain time whilst their brain was being monitored. And a split second before they decided to touch the button, stuff happened in their brain, basically. So the implication, or rather the implication, or rather the conclusion drawn, was that the urge to press the button was not the person. It was something going on in their head. And so we have no free will. I'd say that's complete rubbish. You know, it's just that the conscious part of our mind is the very end of a complex system, which is still part of us. You know, Tesla claims those inventions. I claim my poetry and my work. So those books, those two books and the other book that's coming out, you know, that came to me about a year after I started drinking ayahuasca. I was an insomniac all my life. And then what happened was I started writing at night with furious urgency. And I wouldn't be able to sleep. And then suddenly I'd get an idea into my head and I'd write like a maniac. And I folded these bits of paper up and I stuck them in an envelope. And then after I'd been doing this for about a year, a friend of mine had read some writing I'd done on the internet. She said, "Have you written anything else?" And I said, "Well, yeah, just these scrappy bits of paper." And she goes, "Well, let's have a look at them." And I read, she said, "Can I read one?" I said, "No, you can't. It's completely legible, but I'll read it to you." So I read one to her and she goes, "Well, that's interesting. Let's read some more." And basically we read through all these 90 or so bits of paper. And she made some themes and she helped me categorize it and organize it and put it together. But what happened was, you know, I called them secrets. So in secret number one would relate to something that was in secret number 30. This chunk of text would be here. And again, with this kind of making fluid the fixed, solve it, coagula, I was bringing it all together and separating it out. And I spent it was about a year, all that stuff bubbling up. And then the next 15 years editing it, putting it back together. So the ideas had all come up already, but then I had to kind of make sense out of it, put it into order.
You were on a roll there, man. That was great. I just had one thought during that. You know, you were talking about animals and you were talking about genius. And for some reason, I've always found it curious that the word genius and the word genus are closely related to each other, you know, just one letter different. Obviously, you would think they'd come from the same Latin root, but I don't know anything about the history of those words. Are they connected in any way?
Oh, mate, I don't know. There's gin and there's genie as well, you know. Yeah. And there's all kinds of stuff going on in my genes, but no idea.
Okay, hold on a second. My cat's bugging me. Okay. Anyways, speaking of animals, actually, she shows up right when I start talking about animals.
Yeah, they tend to have this kind of supernatural intelligence to be able to mess with things. I think they're psychic. I'm sure cats are psychic.
I'm sure there's something.
There's that kind of work by Sheldrake on dogs, and in fact not just dogs but other animals that are psychic. So what he did was he put a video camera in a house and which had dogs in it, and then with a random number generator asked people to leave their workplace, and was videoing what happened. So a dog that would have spent like 5% of the day at the window, when the owner decides to leave, because he's told to leave, the dog will suddenly run to the window and then spend 50% of the next 10 minutes, or however long it takes for the owner to get home. One of the things that ayahuasca does is it seems to potentiate the amygdala and the more animal parts of your mind, if you like, the reptilian brain, and it's associated with psychism, with being psychic. In fact, it was called harmaline before it was called harmaline. It was called telepathine because it was said to be that chemical which made us psychic. So I get the feeling that going down away from them. In fact, I know a guy who's a professional palmist. He's a palmistry teacher, in fact, and an amazing psychic. I don't know if I'm giving away a bit too much, but he had two car crashes that damaged his frontal lobes. And, you know, he's got all the classical frontal lobe damage symptomology, like he can't control himself. He can control himself to a degree, but, you know, when he's keen on a woman, it's just written all over his face. He can't hide it at all. Echolalia, like if someone has an accent, he just kind of copies their accent all the time. But he's an amazing psychic because the things that bubble up from his unconscious, he just says them without any interference from the prefrontal cortex, from the frontal lobes.
I'm kind of that way too, but it's more of in a like a rude way. I just have no filter. I just say whatever the hell I want to say. So
blame it on the frontal lobes, man. Blame it on the frontal lobes.
Absolutely. So I said I that was my last question on cognition, the one I posed back to you, but I lied. You and this is going to talk a little bit about psychedelics now, but you said, or you describe in your book that psilocybin, you know, the property in mushrooms that make them psychoactive. You describe psilocybin as unconstrained cognition. I love that term. but I don't know what it means. So could you tell us what it means?
I think I stole that off someone. So Robin Carhart Harris did quite a lot of the, he actually says psilocybin, I say psilocybin, but I think you've got it right and he's got it right. So he did a lot of the psilocybin research, and he made a very interesting, he's actually on my brain, in fact. I had my brain in one of the one of those big perm machines whilst they injected me with psilocybin. So what it does is it inhibits the anterior cingulate cortex, which is one of the connector hubs, one of the major connector hubs of the brain. So then he describes it like this. He gives a very interesting political metaphor. He says, what would happen if you were to bomb the capital city of a country? Well, there'd be a great deal of anarchy and there'd be confusion. And then the different towns would have to make their own connections. Rather than going through the main connecting hub, they'd have to make their own connections. So what you see in a brain on psilocybin, basically, is different regions going into harmonious, basically setting up traffic between them without going through the central connecting hub. Interestingly enough, you see something very similar with autism, because autistic brains, it appears that they don't do synaptic pruning as much as other brains. So synapses kind of... dendrites grow out the end of neurons and connect all over the place, and then as we grow older they get pruned and they get cut down, so our certain pathways get laid down, they get myelinated, and particular paths of thought, paths of cognition get more, we get basically more stuck in our ways on neurological level. So with psilocybin and with other psychedelics that inhibit the connection, the main connecting, you get other connections. So giving you an example of this, synesthesia, so some information will come in from the auditory system, it's a sound, but it gets represented in the visual system as maybe waves coming out the speakers. Another example is that if you're familiar with the Stroop test, which is basically you get a series of words, so it might be like mountain and frog and all these kinds of things, they're in different colors, right? Now it's very easy to say those words regardless of what color they're printed in, but then if the words are like red, yellow, orange, and the word red is printed in orange, and the word yellow is printed in blue and stuff, and you're trying to say the words but not the actual colors that it's printed in, that gets really, really confusing. And it gets doubly confusing if you're on psilocybin, because it's very difficult to separate the sensation from the word, from the lexis and the vocabulary. So yeah, everything gets mixed up, which is, you know, quite troubling if you have to, you know, speak, for example. But it's very good if you need to think. So for example, imagine that I'm having a very bad time with my wife, and I might think, my wife's a nightmare, my wife equals nightmare, and then I might take a nice big dose of something and the edges come off that, right? Those distinct my wife nightmare, and it might get a bit a little bigger and some more comes into that. So maybe it's my wife and me are a nightmare, and maybe there's something I can work on there, you know. Maybe she's not just a nightmare, maybe she's a nightmare in certain contexts. So
yeah,
that you know, that's the case for psilocybin and psychedelics, that's the case for autism. It's also the case for meditation, certain types of meditation, not all types, but a lot of types. The parietal lobe is inhibited and the temporal lobe is inhibited. It basically means the parietal lobe is the bit of your brain which is involved up here, which is involved in definition, as in setting the edges on things. So I look at something and I say, oh, it's a thing, and then another bit of my brain says it's a tree, like the other tree and the other tree. Whereas autists, for example, will look at a tree and they might see a bunch of leaves, they might see a trunk, they might see a bit of this, bit of that, and then slowly it form into a thing, right? Now, one of the things which is defined in the parietal lobes is the self as well, the edge of the self, right? So people with parietal lobe damage, they reach for things carelessly, for example. But when you inhibit that, and you can inhibit that through, like I say, meditation, the edges of the self start to become porous. And we can kind of merge with the universe. We can merge with the process of meditation. We can merge with the prayer, for example, that's being said. So yeah, all kinds of things dissolve the boundaries. Surprise, illness, psychedelics, sleep as well. That dissolves the boundaries. All the states in which you see people, scientists, coming up with revelations, among other things, and artists as well, Mozart and you know and other people.
Yeah, when you were talking there about your wife equals nightmare, that made me, I tweet sometimes, and sometimes I tweet out random thoughts, obviously, because that's what Twitter is. But I had a thought a while ago where I was like, you know, I think it'd be great that if you could just strap certain people to a chair and just shove 5 grams of mushrooms into them and just strap them to that chair, lock them down, 5 grams of mushrooms, and just shove it in their mouth. And I know that that disrupts the whole set and setting thing. It's not probably not the best mindset to be in if you're strapped to a chair and you can't move. Not the best setting either. But I just think that that's sort of like a forced apocalypse, probably. That's probably not the best way to do it. But I would love to do that.
Oh, it could certainly be entertaining.
Yeah, definitely. Let's forget that for a moment, because that's probably a crime in a lot of different countries.
That is a crime in a lot of different ways. Yeah. I think. Yeah. I've had the same kind of fantasies as well. Political leaders, you know, but nah, I don't think so. I think certain, you know, if you have a revelation at the wrong time, in the wrong condition, it's just going to lay down a whole load of nonsense. The Buddhists talk about this in the Pali tradition. They talk about false jhana, which are kind of a revelation at the wrong time, an insight at the wrong time, and it kind of crystallizes a whole load of stuff. So, you know, taking acid, I've got one friend who took acid, and it kind of went really, really badly wrong for him. It wasn't in the right, and he was away with the fairies for years and years and years. Didn't really come back, actually. So no, it's a lovely idea, but I don't think it's that easy. I think there needs to be a good, you know, some heavy doses and quite a big dose of kindness. And having said that, if you strap yourself down and have seven grams, you might find that those dangerous thoughts trouble you less.
Yeah, that's probably what I should do, is just strap myself down. You're right. So a lot of your work does deal in biblical scripture, which people that have heard this conversation to this point might be surprised by. But you're actually I call you a scholar, because just from reading your second book here, you know a lot about the Bible. And you have insights into it that I've never read before. I want to talk a little bit about that, and I'm going to start off with a quote here. Linguistics, culture, history, geography, and cosmology are weaved together as spools of a giant tapestry worked down through the generations. I think a good example of this, perhaps, is the biblical phrase, in the beginning, which you claim that is mistranslated or misrepresented. So what can you tell us about that phrase, in the beginning, and what it actually means?
So let me just kind of make something clear here. The Old Testament, which is obviously in Hebrew, is said to have 70 faces for every interpretation of a verse, right? So I think a lot of people, evangelical Christians, for example, seem to be trying to find out what the text actually says and what the rule actually says and how you live the right life. Very much like certain rather unimaginative scientists are trying to work out what the truth is, because science grows straight out of Indo-European New Testament scripture, basically. And the Old Testament is different. And the translation of the Old Testament is described as a lion in a cage. Think about the image, a lion, something very powerful, but it's trapped, right? So in the beginning, I don't think that calling it in the beginning is a mistranslation. It doesn't have the word the in it. There's no article there. So it could mean in beginning, right? We tend to get quite fascinated with first causes generally, in a way that perhaps the ancient Hebrews were not. So Bereshit starts Bereshit bara Elohim, right? Where to go? I mean, there's whole books written about the first line of the Bible. I think maybe one of the interesting things to think about in terms of that is Hebrew isn't written with vowels, right? It's written without vowels. The vowel points were set in the 7th century AD. So it'd been around, certain parts of the Bible had been around for probably around 1700 years before the vowels were set. And the oral tradition goes back even further than that. So there was a long time where what it meant could be completely different, basically, according to how you decide to pronounce it. So in the same way that hot and hit and hut and hat all mean different things, in Hebrew that would be HT or some equivalent. And you would decide what was appropriate. And that you could decide that on your tradition of reading, or you could decide that on what was going on in your community, or any number of things, right? Another thing about Hebrew is it was probably written originally, the Bible, without spaces. If you look at contemporary texts, the Gezer calendar, for example, which is written in Paleo Hebrew, so the language that the Bible was originally written in, the script rather than the language was literally written in, is written without spaces, right? And the Rambam, who wrote the commentary on Genesis, this is a very kind of mainstream Jewish sage, one of the highest authorities, he wrote that the Torah was originally written in black fire on white fire, and it was written without spaces. And if you break up the words differently, it reveals different secrets, right? You can see how that works in English a little bit. On my website is Danny D. Hypnotherapy, right? It's not Danny D. Hypnotherapist, which is my job, because if you break up that a little bit differently, it would be Danny D, Hypno, the Rapist. So yeah. Breaking up words differently, breaking up sentences differently, can reveal completely different, I was going to say secrets, completely different meanings, right? So if you take that first word, Bereshit, or the first three words rather, Bereshit bara Elohim, and you take the last two letters, the Yod and the Tet, off, is it Tet? Tav, sorry, Yod and Tav, off the first word, Bereshit, and put it on the second word, then the first word isn't Bereshit anymore, it's Barosh. And then the second word is not bara, which means create, or created, or is creating, it becomes yit bara. So instead of meaning in the beginning God created, it means barosh, means in the head, right? Barosh means in the head. And then the next word becomes passive. In the head is created, or were created, and the third word, Elohim, the gods, or the powers, or God. Elohim is also a very complicated word, which is both singular, plural, masculine, feminine, and abstract, right? So there's another way of reading the first line. And this isn't some wild theory out of nowhere. This is one of the greatest of Jewish sages of all time, who actually gives this as a specific example of how you can break up the first few words of the Bible. If you continue doing that over the rest of the sentence, which normally is read, in the beginning God created the heaven and earth, you can change it to be, in the head was created God, you are heaven and you are earth, which is a very beautiful way of beginning that particular beautiful book, a beautiful story. So there's quite a lot to be said about Bereshit bara. Another thing is it's got bara as the first three letters, and it goes Bereshit and then bara, right? Bara means to create, right? Now, the creator God in the Puranic literature, from the Indian tradition, is Brahma, which is rather interesting because it's got the same combination of three letters, bara. And you see quite a lot of, if you look for them, you see quite a lot of parallels between Hebrew words and Puranic gods as well, like sh, the letter sh in Hebrew, Bereshit, or Shamayim, which means heaven. Sh is the second last letter in the Hebrew alphabet, and it's also one of the mother letters. It's the mother letter of fire. It's the destroying letter. And of course, Shiva is a destroying god in the Puranic literature. And yeah, loads to be said about that. I mean, literally, the whole book's about this. The Zohar is all about the first part of the Bible.
On the same path, then, some other words that I think are worth pointing out here, too, that you write about, the words evening, morning, and cosmos, all have different meanings than what we may think they mean.
So the first story, there's two stories of creation. The first story of creation, let's find it, okay? So it goes something like, in the beginning God created the heaven and earth, and earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, which is rather interesting. So we've got the idea of the surface, and we've got the idea of the deep, right? So the darkness is on the face. You can't see what's beyond. So already we're talking about an apocalypse, or something which is a depth which isn't perceived yet, right? And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. So look at that. First is the word. The speaking happens first. Then there's the existence of the thing. God said, let there be light, and there was light. And then there's the perception of the thing. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And this is maps very, very closely onto what goes on with the brain, because the word, a word is a defined thing. Maybe we were talking about the parietal lobes earlier, which define things, right? When something is defined, it then gets named, and it gets named with neologism, which involves the frontal lobes. And then the name sticks, becomes fixed, and that's what the word shem, as in name, means fixed, a fixed thing, a noun, a category in the temporal lobes, right? So first there is the word. You can't really perceive something if you don't have an idea of it already, right? It's actually probably this actually particular thing is just going to get a little bit too complex. I'll answer your question a bit more directly. And the evening and the morning were the first day. At the end of every day, every cycle of creation has this line, and the evening and the morning were the first day, and the evening and morning were the second day, and the evening and the morning were the third day. Now that's the King James Version Bible. In the Hebrew, it doesn't say that. It says, and the evening and the morning were day one. And then the second one, it says, and the evening and the morning were the second day, the evening and the morning were the third day. So on and so forth. They're ordinal numbers, but one is not, one is a cardinal number, right? Day one. So the rabbis ask, why is it day one? Why isn't it the first day? Because there is a way of saying the first day in Hebrew, but that's not what's said in the text. And the rabbis answer, because it wasn't actually the first day. The world had been created and destroyed many, many times before, right? Which is kind of interesting in itself. So this comes back to the idea of in the beginning. It's maybe not the beginning. It might be beginning. In beginning, God created. You know, he might have begun it again. And I think, I mean, my interpretation of this is it's actually a baby being born and seeing the surface, you know, when the eyes aren't really formed enough to see depth perception, and gradually perceiving more and more the world, learning what a defined thing is, and then mapping it onto the things that you see, and then dividing it from other things. And God divided the light from the darkness, so on and so forth. So evening in Hebrew is Erev, and morning was Boker. Now, in my experience, I wake up in the morning, I go to bed in the evening, right? So why does the text say, and it was evening and it was morning? Why does the day start in the evening when surely it should start in the morning, right? And one of the great sages answered this question by saying, the root of the word Erev, as in evening, is disorder, chaos, right? And the root of the word Boker is discern, to discern. So at the end of every cycle, and it was evening and it was morning, something has arisen out of chaos into be something which is discernible, as in it has edges, it's defined in some sense. And every time it's good, you see, so to the emergence of order out of chaos, the emergence of something discernible, certainly from the perspective of Pythagoras, for example, he talks about cosmos coming out of chaos, order coming out of chaos. And he says order is beautiful, cosmos is beautiful. Cosmos also means a jewel, right? And you think about what a jewel is, in the context of something you find underground, where underground, you know, it's just loads of kind of mashed up bits of rock. And then suddenly you've got a very orderly, very beautiful, very angular thing that you find in there, a diamond or an emerald or something. So order within chaos, order is a beautiful thing. When order gets too tight, then you need to make fluid the fix. Then you're back into salve et coagula. So it's, you know, a continual drive towards order, and you get the new world order, and you get oppression, all that kind of stuff. So it's not an endless process, but generally the process towards more order is a good thing. So this idea of a discernible thing, right? Let me take an example of shells on the beach, right? Imagine on the beach, there's all these shells and they're scattered around in a chaotic arrangement. And you take those things and you arrange them into a line. Now, the word in Hebrew for to arrange something into a line, which is three letters, it's dalet, bet, resh, dabar. That is the root of the word dabar or davar. And that means in Hebrew, in English, it means word, as in defined thing. And it also means thing. I think it's the only language where the same word is used for word and thing, which is really interesting. Because if you think about where is that line, you know, you're looking at it on the beach, but a moment ago you had a bunch of chaos. And then you just arranged chaos into a line, as in you deburred it. And now you've got a thing, but where's the thing? Is the thing on the beach or is the thing in your mind? You see what I'm saying? Right? Where what is it that brings together one shell and the next shell and the next shell and the next shell and the next shell? Right? The bar is the ordering of it, the arranging of it. Logos. Again, logos is described by Philo, for example, as the glue and chain which brings everything together. And in the very next chapter of his book, he says it's the divider which divides all things. So think about that line again on the beach. That line brings together the shells, but it also divides two parts of the beach. And those lines are very important. They exist in our heads. They don't exist. Well, maybe they exist in the world, but it's very difficult to say whether a line of shells exists in the world. But they're so important that people are prepared to fight and kill over lines drawn in the sand. Right? The edges of countries, for example. So this comes back to this question of where is the first thing? So, and God said, there's the word, let there be light, and there was light. So the word comes first, and then once there's a word for it, we can perceive it. And God saw the light, and then there's a value judgment that it was good. You know, my side of the, you know, you see the line, you see my side of the beach. My side of the beach is good. That means your side of the beach is bad. And then you've got the value judgment, and we're talking about the temporal lobes, right? So this process of cognition, I find in various ways expressed in the Bible. I mean, this is just kind of scratching the surface of it here in Genesis 1. And again, in Genesis 2, you've got this wonderful line, out of the ground, Yahweh Elohim, who's a different God, by the way, totally different personality. Yahweh Elohim formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and he brought them unto Adam to see what he was called them. Why doesn't he name them himself?
Yeah.
Because it's a different part of the brain. The frontal lobes are what makes words, right? And when we're talking about frontal lobes, I think we're talking about Adam, we're talking about Noah, we're talking about the humans in the story of the frontal lobes. When we're talking about the definition of things, Yahweh Elohim, we're talking about parietal lobes. Then when we're talking about El Shaddai, all these different God names, you know, this gets quite detailed and quite involved, as you'll have read it in my book, but the different god names seem to in many ways map onto different parts of the brain, different processes of cognition.
Yeah, man, that is maybe the most fascinating thing that I read in the book. And then as you're talking about cognition in the Bible, there's also some evidence of mental illness in the Bible. This is something that I've not heard before, but you break it down pretty well.
Yeah, so there's some quite specific things. There's one quite interesting line, one of the Psalms, if I should forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand lose its cunning, let my tongue stick to the roof of my mouth. I think that's what it says, which is describing an epileptic fit. Right, someone can't speak, someone loses control of one side of their body. So there's that. I think rather than a mental illness, I would say non-normal mental or non-normal experience, right? So there are people who hear voices in the Bible all over the place, and they hear voices in the same way that people who hear voices these days hear them. So the most common thing that people hear when they hear voices is their own name said, right? That's how the gods, the god names appear to Abraham. Abraham, Abraham. And Abraham says, here am I. Moses, Moses, here am I, right? That's how they open discussions with. And that's how the voices of voice here is open discussion. Now, we tend to be terrified of voices because we live in a shadow of ignorance, really. But if you look at the dissociative identity disorder forums, there's quite a fair degree of consensus on how you deal with voices. That's the forums, the internet forums on people who hear voices. And one of the ways you do it is by focusing on one of the voices. So drowning out not focusing on the others, focusing on one, trying to get their name out of them, right? Now, A, that's really interesting because in occultism, that's how you get power over a demon or an entity is by finding out its name. And in fact, even in shamanism, the idea of an ikaro is a phrase of music. So rather than a phrase of letters, a word, it's a specific phrase of music, which gives you the power to kind of transmit the power of a particular plant or an elemental force or something like that. So a particular name. Now, and also in the Bible, you know, they keep on asking, like Moses, when he meets Yahweh, he says, what should I call you? And Yahweh says, I am that I am. But you can call me I am to your friends, right? I am Yehi. And it was evening and it was morning. Vayehi Erev. Vayehi Yahweh. It's the same word. Beness, isness is what Yahweh's name is. So back to the voice hearers. Some of the forums talk about people developing good names, good relationships with the voices in their heads. And then, you know, you don't hear so much about people who have good relationships with voices in their heads. I've got a friend who's an acupuncturist, and one of the ways that she does her job is by listening to the voices in her head. Now, she doesn't go to take herself to the psychiatrist and say, I've got voices in my head. She charges people money to, as the voices in her head are telling you where to put the things. Right? So voices are quite helpful sometimes. Some people, again, on the forums will say, you know, the voices used to be troubling, and quite often they do come in an aggressive manner. But if you develop a good relationship with the voices, then they start to tell you things like people would give the example of one of the examples in my book is someone was told by, he's a farmer, and the voices tell him, oh, your cows are broken into the feed room, for example. And off he goes, and yeah, they have. Someone else is looking for her camera, and he says, oh, your camera's in your bag. Oh, yeah, so it was. Now, this is very common in occultism, in kind of shamanism, the idea of making an enemy spirit into an ally, right, by learning its name. What does a name mean? In Hebrew, Shem, it means fixed. So once you pin it down and hold it down, get a power over it, get it to behave itself, and it becomes your ally, right? And so Moses says, for example, how can I go and challenge Pharaoh? I'm gaggle. That's probably the Portuguese. I'm gan. I've got a stutter. And Yahweh says, I will be with thee, right? So you don't need to worry about your rubbish manner of speech. He said, actually, uncircumcised lips is the word he uses. But Yahweh puts words into his mouth. And sometimes we find that, I don't know, if artists find that their pen is controlled. Like William Blake talks about this, writing against his will, you know, dictation, 12 or 16 lines at a time. Nietzsche, again, it also talks about an overwhelming, like floods of tears and overwhelming urge to write. I mean, I know my experience, it was an absolute urgency to write. And if anything got in my way of writing, I would be very, very short with them. And, you know, sometimes the words will come faster than I can get them down. I think it's a very common experience in artists, in writers, of that compulsion. Interestingly enough, you see it with And there's examples of people who had medicine for epilepsy, who might reduce their dose, for example. There's a woman who reduced her dose and then started compulsively writing poetry, right? So epilepsy, there's another, it's a kind of mental illness, I suppose. But the phenomenology of it, which is convulsions, seeing visions, ecstasy, terror, they're all described in the literature of mystics and also experiences of visitation in the Bible. So, you know, seeing visions, people see visions. Perhaps those visions give us information of something that's actually there. And this kind of keys into another thing. The early Gnostics were taking instruction directly from Jesus resurrected in spirit, not resurrected in the flesh, resurrected in the spirit. That means Jesus coming back in dreams, Jesus coming back in visions, things like that. And you see that in like for example, the Gospel of Mary Magdalene. Jesus appears to her and says something along the lines of, don't accept any law from a lawgiver, right? Obviously not very conducive to the aims of empire and the expanding Roman Empire at the time. The Roman Empire wanted people to follow their bishops, but people were following the voices in their head, right? And perhaps the voices in their heads, you know, it's better not to think of them in terms of pathology, but just another apocalypse, you know, another level of experience. In fact, all voices are in my head, you know. If I go to the shop and I buy some bread, then the guy says that'll be £1.50 now, and that what he says is converted into a whole load of kind of electrical information in my head, right? So the voices we hear, in some way they are transmitted through our brains, through our central nervous system. So the idea that we would preferentially believe that those voices are real, whereas the other voices are not real, well, that hasn't really been tested, you know. I don't think it's been tested to a great degree. Can people pick up things from that they're not aware of? You know, my wife had a series of prophetic dreams when we were in Brazil, and one of them involved kind of a particular place. I'll tell you about this story. You'll like this. She had a dream about broken glass in a particular area. And the next day we went to a particular place. She'd never been there before. She said, this is the place. And to cut a long story short, the following day we went there, she started digging into the ground and dug up like 6 sacks of glass out of the ground. And the glass had been buried there about, must have been in the 1970s, I think. So we're talking about 40 years before, 40, 50, how long, where are we now? Yeah, well, in the 70s, before she was born anyway, by a kind of black magician whose rituals involved smashing together bottles of rum and stamping on the glass and then burying it, right? So, you know, the voices, the visions, we see them all over in the Bible. We also see them all over in the psychiatric institutions. You also, you know, witches hear them all the time, but people tend to keep their witchiness to themselves. They won't get drowned anymore, but they might get thrown into mental institutions.
Yeah, for sure. And there's another thing in the Bible that we should mention that you're well-versed in speaking about and writing about. I don't want to spend too much time on it because I know that you've talked about it at length for the past several months and maybe even years, to be honest. But there are a lot of references to what we would call drugs or psychedelics in the Bible. I think specifically we should just mention the 8 head spices. That to me is the most pertinent thing to our conversation here because they're actually pretty simple. You could find some of them in your kitchen right now, I imagine, that could induce a psychedelic experience, right?
Indeed, yeah. So here's the line. It's from the Song of Songs. Thy plants are an orchard of pomegranates, pleasant fruits, camphire with spikenard and saffron, cane and cinnamon, with all trees of frankincense, myrrh and agar wood, with all the chief spices. Now, where do we start? Spikenard, that's the stuff that Jesus' feet are washed with later on in the New Testament. Spikenard is a booster of dopamine, serotonin, GABA. It's described as a nootropic. That means it assists in the formation of memories. Myrrh works on the opioid system, works on mu and delta opioid receptors. Frankincense, which I chew regularly because it's lovely, works on the GABA system. The GABA receptors are the most common receptors in your brain, or 40% of neurons. They're the same receptors that Valium works on, which is not to say that frankincense does the same thing as Valium, but it does work on the same receptors. Frankincense also contains another compound substance which works on the TRPV3 ion channel, which is distributed very widely in the skin, where it's involved in temperature reception, and it's also distributed in the brain. We don't know what it does in the brain, but we do know it does something because it's in the brain and it's an ion channel. And bear in mind that frankincense was taken from Oman, to Palestine, right, which is 1,500 miles through robber-infested deserts. It's a six-month trek, right? And before it was burnt to Yahweh, it was burnt to Baal in Canaan. Before it was burnt to Baal, it was burnt to Ra. You know, we're talking about many thousands of years before Common Era, before Christ, that frankincense was lugged across the jungle, across the desert. So serious stuff. And you've got, what else have you got? Cinnamon, that's the one that'll be in your kitchen probably. That contains eugenol, which is what you can make MDMA out of. Cassia contains estradiol, which is described in Erowid as having an electric LSD-like effect, right? Cassia's not in that particular line, but everything, pretty much everything in that line is edible, psychoactive, and pleasant. Canair bossum is a whole other kind of line of research. It looks very much like it's Canair boss. In Zingo, it's Canair boss. And the Scythians burned cannabis, the Greeks burned cannabis, the Persians, the Babylonians, everyone. There's archaeological evidence, there's scriptural, textual evidence. They burned something called cannabis, canub, canna. In English, it's all in Hebrew, it's canne bosom. I'll kind of refer you to Chris Bennett's research. He's done quite a whole load on this. But okay, I guess what's really interesting about the Bible is not that it's got drugs in it, because, you know, until we had hysteria over drugs, obviously there are drugs everywhere. Still are drugs everywhere. But the combinations of them. So you have the anointing oil, for example, Shemen Hamishcha, and it comes from the word mashach, which means to wipe or to paint. It's where we get the word massage from. It's a massage oil put upon priests so they could have an experience of Yahweh, put upon kings so they could have an experience of Yahweh. It was very specifically in order to introduce people to the spirit of Yahweh. And it's a combination of myrrh, cinnamon, cassia, and canne bosum, right? Now, to cut a long story short, those four, they all contain very, very powerful psychoactives. Well, let's talk about cassia and cinnamon in particular, contain very powerful psychoactives. But if you eat them on their own, they won't affect you because your enzymes break them down. Just like with the ayahuasca, if you eat loads of DMT, it won't affect you because you need harmaline or harmine or something to inhibit your monoamine oxidase enzymes, which break down the DMT. So eugenol, estradiol, mistriacin, all these allobenzenes are broken down by the cytochrome enzymes, the P450 enzymes, right? Now, they have to be inhibited in order for you to get the effect of these wonderful allobenzenes in the brain. And they're inhibited with myrrh, cassia, cinnamon, and cannabis, right? So the spectrum of those particular four oils which go into the anointing oil, which gives one the experience of Yahweh, and has taboos all around it, like you can't get drunk beforehand. Once you've got it on you, you can't go stumbling around the streets, so on and so forth. It knocks out the enzymes. So it actually makes a chemical profile quite similar to nutmeg. And nutmeg on its own is psychoactive. Go easy on your dose, people. Make sure you know what you're doing. So probably about one nutmeg ground up. Probably won't be enough, but try that. And then another day, try 1.5 nutmegs. See if that works. But if you have 3 or 4 nutmegs straight away, you'll give yourself a stonking headache. So just be careful your dose. With all these things, be careful your dose. Just because they are herbs that you can buy in the shop doesn't mean to say the combinations aren't mega, mega, mega powerful, because they are. You need to be careful. But nutmeg contains both the inhibitors and the allobenzene psychoactive compounds, which is why it's effective on its own. But nutmeg grew in the middle of nowhere on a little island that the English and Dutch fought 2 wars over much later on in time. So the Israelites, and actually before them the Egyptians, had a very similar mixture, which was cassia, myrrh, and cinnamon. So this stuff has been, you know, the apothecaries of the ancient time. We shouldn't forget how they were master apothecaries. The Egyptians, they built the pyramids, they did brain surgery, they invented antibiotics. You know, these people were total masters in certain areas, which it's difficult for us to fathom how they could manage to get the pyramids so flat or pointed towards the north. Man, these people had absolute skills. And I think actually, in terms of literature, in terms of poetry, the Israelites, or certainly some poets amongst the Israelites, had comparable skills, because the complexity of the text of the Bible is absolutely mind-boggling. And I'm not just talking about the words but also the numbers as well. The numbers get really, really complicated in the Bible. There's one other thing I want to say about the Bible, is that there's different texts in the Bible, the different documents that go into making up the Bible. So whilst I really like what's called the Yahwist, I really like the Elohist, those are ones which are written without law. or at least very few laws. The Yahweh's got one law: don't eat blood. All this stuff about, you know, don't diss your mum, don't covet your neighbor's ox. You know, I like coveting my neighbor's ox, but that comes in later, comes in later text. And then when you get to Deuteronomy and you get all that kind of capitalist property owning class law, that's not the same author's, completely different culture, completely different society which produces it. So, you know, obviously I'm fascinated by the Bible, but I'm fascinated with different bits of it in different ways. And I'm interested in, this is what I said in that quote, which you, where was it? Stories weave through the generations. Oh no, that's another one. But,
yeah, it was linguistics, culture, history, geography, and cosmology are weaved together as spools of a giant tapestry worked down through the generations.
Yeah, exactly. So there's a whole lot of politics that comes into the Bible. There's priestcraft that comes into the Bible. There's 1,000 years, you know, Babylon, that's kind of 500 BC. You've got about 500 years up to Daniel. Daniel's written about 200 BC. So even before you get to the New Testament, you've got like 800-900 years worth. It's a library, basically. It's a library bouncing off. It's a whole textual tradition, and we can learn a lot about it. And one of the things we can learn about it is how science is reflected in the levels of it. So you've got two books which are revelatory books, the Elohist and the Yahwist, and then you've got a priestly book which is basically created in order to manage how people were running the cult. And then you've got Deuteronomy, which is all about, like I say, property owning class, or property and the laws around property. And if you look into how science goes from the revelation that happens in someone's head through the level of priestcraft, which is basically the journals, what you're allowed to publish, what you're allowed to say, what you're not allowed to say, all that kind of stuff, and then into the pharmaceuticals companies, into the laws, patent laws, all that kind of stuff, it's very interesting. You get revelation and then priestcraft and then capital, both in the Bible and in the passage of science from someone's mind into society.
Yeah, man, that was a pretty eye-opening part of the book that I did not really make the connection to. So I'm glad that you put that in there, and I'm glad that you spoke to it here now. There are a couple things that I wanted to talk about that, just for the sake of time, I'm not going to be able to get to. I just want to throw them out there because I may want to talk to you again soon about ritual poetics, which I have an interest in. I thought that was a pretty interesting thing. That's not in your book. It was part of a talk that you gave a couple years ago that you sent me through email that's on your website, which I thought to be pretty interesting. And then also the concept of cognitive or philosophical anarchy, which I thought was also interesting. That was in your book, talking about Deuteronomy, I think, specifically. So unless you have more time, I know it's late where you're at, but I don't necessarily want to hold you up if I don't have
No, I'm
to.
All right, man. Let's go. Let's go. It's cool.
Hey, sorry to cut in here, but I had to tell you this. At this point in our conversation, we took a quick bathroom break, and when we returned from that, somehow my question to Danny on the topic of ritual poetics did not get recorded. I don't know exactly what the question was either, because I did not anticipate him having more time than we allotted, and therefore did not have anything really prepared on the subject that I could refer back to rephrase the question here in post-production. It did have something to do with the laws of poetry and this passage specifically from a presentation he gave on the subject, and the passage is this: myth and plot, meter and rhyme, structuring life in space and time, lines of meaning cutting through it, ink on the page of the master poet. Life is very strange, and so is magic, but they both seem to follow laws as inviolable as the laws of physics. These are the laws of poetry. So let's hear Danny respond to whatever the hell I asked him concerning these laws of poetry.
There was something from the talk. There was a young man in Japan whose tea said, "I am that I am." You can predict what words will come in poetry, right? You know that if it goes diddler diddler am, and the next line is going to go diddler diddler am, right? There was a young man in Japan whose tea said, "I am that I am." And if you know "I am that," you know something about the plot, then you know that it's going to be "I am that I am," right? When we do magic, we arrange symbols into an order. That's what a spell is. That's why it's called a spell. Same way that we spell words by putting letters into order. And when we look into a grimoire, we're looking at grammar, right? Which is how you arrange words into order. Spell casting, incanting, is the arranging of symbols into order, and they predict, in my experience, I was going to say my belief, in my experience, they predict certain results. And because there are laws in poetry, the same way you can predict the dam will the next week will go am or something. You can kind of predict within the meter, within the rhyme scheme, and within the plot what kind of results will emerge, right? So for example, when I was ill, I got sick. I'm going to show you a scar. That's my scar there, right? Which is leishmania. Oh no, we're on the radio, aren't we? So you're not going to see my scar. Right. But it's under my left nipple where I got bitten by a sandfly, and this grew into an illness. I was sick for 8 months, and for about 4 months of those, well, I was drinking. I decided I can treat it with ayahuasca. Now, why did I do that? I'd gone to Brazil very specifically to learn about ayahuasca in the Daimi tradition and to finish my book, which was about a lot of what we talked about already, but a lot of it about medicine, a lot of it about authority, a lot of it about anarchy as well. And I got bitten by this sandfly, and I was, what was I to do? So people told me I had to take injections, otherwise I would lose the cartilage in my nose and ears, because it's quite a serious disease. It's a cousin of leprosy. It's called leishmaniasis. And so I decided to, I took a dose, and the visions I saw encouraged me to continue doing what I was doing. I'd gone there to learn about ayahuasca. I'd gone there to learn about disease, what about the meaning of disease. So there was an opportunity. So there's the plot, right? Something that happened to me fitted into a plot. And if I was going to break that rhyme scheme, if I was going to break that particular plot line, then I would have been abandoning that poem, put it like that, right? So I treated it. I drank daimi every day for about 4 months and did a lot of ceremonies. I lost 10 kilos. I lost an ex-wife. Loads and loads of stuff happened. But I met this other woman. At the end, she ended up nursing me back to health the last couple of months. And it was a horrible disease. You know, it was terrifying. It was scary. Scary times. At one point, I had worms coming out of my flesh. Had an ulcer in my body for quite a long time. Then I went home. One day, I got better. Cut a long story so short. I got better. And went off to Bolivia with this woman. Now, she had first met me when I was in a particular... in a particular place, and I was playing with tarot cards, and she came and she picked a card, and it was the lover's card. And I didn't want a woman in my life at that time. In fact, I was celibate because of the disease, but also because of the book. The guiding spirit of it, if you like, was very jealous and wanted my full attention, and everything had gone wrong for women with women for the last, you know, for years and years and years. So I didn't really want a woman in my life. And I told her, this has nothing to do with, you know, I didn't want to be excited about the fact that she picked the lover's card. So I said, oh, this has got nothing to do with lovers. Anyway, so we went off to Bolivia. I bought her a tarot deck there. And all of the cards are printed normally, except for one of them, which was the lover's card, obviously. There's the rhyme, right? This is the same woman who was finding stuff buried in the ground. You know, the dream would present to a thing to her. She'd indicating a place. When she went to the place, she would remember it, as in the rhyme would come up again. The symbol would come up again. She'd dig it up. There it was in the ground. So glass and then glass again. Recurring symbols, plot lines, meter. We went off to Bolivia because my passport had run out. And I'd overstayed my welcome in Brazil, basically. And one day I went to the internet cafe and somebody had written to me saying, two people had written to me saying they dreamt about me, which is something you should always do, by the way. If you dream about someone, you should tell them about it because it's significant. And then someone else had written to me saying they just had a baby and they're very happy. And someone else had written to me saying they just got pregnant and they were very happy. So I wrote to someone saying, do you think if I went home and impregnated this woman, then all my problems would be resolved? And I went back to the hostel and she opened the door and she said, should we have a child? And I went, yeah, all right then. Because, again, it was the rhyme would come back, you know. So I did. We did. We actually had two. We had twins. She fell pregnant immediately, I think. And when the kids were born, they were both born with birthmarks in the same place that I had birthmarks on my... that I had the wound on my chest. So, again, the plot, the meter, the rhyme coming back. I believe that there are certain laws of grammar which organise speech to make it sensible, and there are certain laws of, I'm not sure what to call them, but there's certain structure, mythic structure, if you like, which guide the way that things go. As long as you buy into the myth, as long as you, I wouldn't say believe it, but as long as you act within the confines, the boundary of the myth, right? So when I got ill, I did what was according to the myth that was unfolding. And when I took, I took my children to the curandero who was involved in my cure, the guy, the witch doctor, not witch doctor, not the right word, the curandero, and showed him the birthmarks on my kids, and almost without batting an eyelid, he said, oh, I left a tag. And in that particular place, in that particular world, It's totally, totally normal. It's a very musical culture. It's a very poetic culture. But a wound being passed down, a significant wound being passed down through the generations, is absolutely normal. It's just happens all the time. When I came, I mean, I'm kind of praising the talk a little bit here, but when I came back to England, I found myself as a father of two small children, and, you know, I was working really hard, and the book that I'd written wasn't selling. So I went to see a reader, a tarot reader, and he drew a bunch of cards which were significant for a bunch of reasons. I'm kind of, you know, I'm stripping down the story. There's a whole lot more to it than this. But a couple of cards that he, well, the question I asked him was, should I do, well, what the answer to, I'm not going to tell you what the question was, but the answer to the question was two cards which represented four particular demons, basically, from Goetia, from demonic magic, I suppose. I don't know where your listeners are going to be at with that, but the demons are, as I understand them, they're kind of like the heavy movers, the heavy earth lifters, the dynamite of the occult world, right? So we tend to think of them as evil. I just think of them as powerful, right? And I needed powerful things. So when Solomon wanted to build the temple, he decided he was going to get the really heavy, heavy, heavy entities, right? So he said here, okay, so I drew two cards out of all his deck, and they represented two demons of the day and two demons of the night. And he said, read the descriptions of these demons, and if they're appropriate, then you might think about working with them. And I read the description, and one of them described very, very accurately my situation as it happened. The demon is one who causes men to have sores, like as in wounds, and wounds filled with worms. I had a wound filled with worms, right? He appears in the form of a lion's, of an armed soldier with a lion's head, right? My next door neighbor, his nickname was Leal, which means lion, and he was the bane of my life there when I lived in this particular very dodgy place in Brazil, in the jungle, which had been overtaken by kind of gangsters. And he used to walk around with a weapon. He was called Leal. He appears on a white horse, this demon, Marquis Sabnock. And I was writing a book about the apocalypse, and the apocalypse has a white horse in it. His day is my birthday. His card was the card which I had drawn all the way through my illness was relevant. It was just absurdly relevant already in a story that unfolded and unfolded and unfolded. I decided I was going to do some work with this chap, and I wrote an incantation, and perhaps I should read some of it. Shall I read some of it?
For sure, man. Yeah, go ahead.
There's a little bit of ceremony involved in opening this book, so I'll just do that in my head here, but just bear with me for a second. So I spent a couple of days trying to write a poetic invocation of the Marquis Sabnock. And the first day kind of got a few bits, second day I got a few bits, and the third day this one just came tumbling out of me. It goes like this. Would that souls could easily learn the lessons that a lesion lends, flesh to dripping fluid turns, body quickens in defence, but putrefying acid burns, ulcer opens, worse portends, blood to poison, flesh to worms, terror strikes and fear descends, what will has this companion? What life lives within this boil, what will with mine own will contends and smites my skin to me in toil? Marquis Sabnock here attends, but where the foible of his foil? Why does hell this torment send into my breast and take as spoil my self-made flesh? And so where ends the arc of my dominion? In truth, we never end at all, as through the world the soul extends, where worlds cross, a crucible sits, and countless waters blend, with blazing fire mutable. The archer draws the bow and sends a bolt to worlds more beautiful. Thus the weary soul transcends the limits of its prison. Thus doth Sabnock make amends for shedding flesh, doth free the soul. To his corporals Sabnock lends weapons that they may control and bind their will to greater ends. Realize a higher goal. Hang the man, the soul ascends, for flesh is naught where will is all. As mage he is arisen. As once ye came by insect bite, so this night come ye peaceably. There within my soul's dark night I met thy task obediently. Worms did breed beneath thy blight, and each my tissues greedily. Cut forever that which tied my will to corporality, and thus I won my liberty. Come ye, Sabnock, rend the veil, come without deformity. Deformed was I by your ordeal, thy kiss was my calamity, which broke mine own hermetic seal to purge a deep-held malady. 8 months did pass for it to heal through dire and drawn-out purgatory. hard won was my supremacy. This night Sabnock come as friend, clothed in crystal clarity, speak in ways we comprehend, familiar, without enmity. With this working we suspend the habits of reality. Closed, our circle has no end. Let we three be one company, in unity. So mote it be.
Holy shit, man. So what was the intention behind that then?
I think you'd have to ask the demon for that. I mean, this thing had been tormenting me before I even knew it existed, giving me very specific diseases and trials. You know, whatever, I don't know, I really don't get it. I don't understand how poetry can be so powerful that poetry, which must have come on some level from a human being, if they were channeling some aspect of the divine or the demonic or the other, don't know. But for whatever reason, it seemed to take an interest in me. You know, it's called Guisha. Guisha means the howling. And the question sometimes arises, who's howling at who? Is it us screaming at the demons, yeah, or is it them screaming at us? So, I mean, I think, like I say, it was a real compulsion to write my book. It's been my obsession. The apocalypse has been in my head since I was a teenager. I've been, you know, I wrote for years and years. I wrote all-nighters, you know, what, sometimes twice a week, often once a week, for years and years and years. And I think there was a particular book, a particular apocalypse that, you know, I was still having the pleasure of writing, of making into art. I don't know much more than that. I don't really feel like I've got that much control of my life, really.
Is that a terrifying feeling? Or is that more of like a liberating feeling?
Well, it's better than data entry, you know. It makes life exciting. You know, there's magic in my life. Just weird and interesting things happen. It's never dull, you know. Writing for me is like relaxing. It's when I have to do other things, you know, and I like my work at the moment, but when I have to do jobs I wasn't enjoying, you know, it really felt like an imposition that got in the way of what was kind of bubbling out of me. So, yeah, it's kind of like tense. There's a certain tension in not doing the writing when it's there. I think a lot of artists feel like that, though. You know, they feel like they're obliged to create. It's compulsion, you know. So back to this idea of mental illness, you know, compulsive disorder is a disorder. But, you know, Newton was compulsive. Loads of great scientists have been. Newton, for example, he once threw a dinner party and disappeared off to his room in the middle, and they kind of found him hunched over his papers later, because what he really wanted to do was discover gravity and calculus, you know. Now, I'm not saying that my books are anything like such a monumental work, but I think there is stuff in there. I mean, this thing about drugs in the Bible, I don't think anyone else has come close to. There's no one's picked up on the enzyme interactions. There's a fair amount of original stuff, especially in the second book. So yeah, I do think there is some kind of use of the work that I've been doing.
Well, I will say, man, when you were reading through that incantation, I felt it, man. Like I became really relaxed. I almost like felt like I was in a trance.
Well, I'm a hypnotist as well.
Ah, shit. Yeah, there you go. Oh, man. So the other thing that I wanted to talk about that we can wrap up on here is this idea of anarchy. You know, that's a completely misunderstood term in modern parlance, and it obviously relates to our conversation here. I think the brain on psychedelics could be described as a kind of cognitive anarchy. So I'm curious, though, as it relates to anarchy on a cognitive level or a philosophical level or a societal level, a political, economic level, like, where does your interest in that subject fall? Or is it an all-encompassing interest?
Yeah, no, it's all-encompassing. Like, my politics are anarchist. I'm yet to find a coercive rule which makes any sense to me. You know, having been arrested several times for smoking joints in the wrong places back to when I was a teenager. You know, historically, rules are always there to protect the money-owning class or the property-owning class. All right, right, all the way back to the Bible and beyond to Babylon, the Hammurabi Code. It's very much the nobles are more important than the normal people, who are more important than the slaves. The idea that we will run around and kill each other if we're left to our own devices is childish and stupid. And I guess Noam Chomsky puts it quite well. The opposite, you know, if people can't be trusted, then why are we electing people to positions where they have power not only over themselves and the people nearby them, but over nuclear arsenals and so on and so forth? You know, the anarchists I know are most people, a house party is anarchistic. You know, you don't get the police in when there's an argument at your party. You don't get police in when my kids have an argument and they come to me saying, but they don't come to me anymore saying someone sits, you know, can I say, sort it out yourself. Sort it out. I'm not getting involved. You don't need an authority figure to come and, you know, come and deal with it. And they learn to deal with things themselves, you know. The idea that you're doing someone a favor by hitting them with sticks and putting them in jail, or you're doing anyone a favor by having such institutions. You know, we can have institutions, but if you need to protect your institution with weapons and jail, then I just don't buy it. I guess the argument against anarchy is that we'd all go around killing each other. I mean, look out the window, man. I live in a place called Parsons Green. There was a killing here the other day. There was a bomb went off here a couple of weeks ago. You know, we are running around killing each other on a global scale, killing millions. You know, the Iraq War. That was kind of a political eye opener for me. I went on that march against the Iraq War when Tony Blair decided to invade that country. Our political wishes were completely ignored. We don't have any political power in the political. Well, we do have political power, but we need to take it.
But isn't there some neuroscience behind the concept of restriction placed upon people, that the more restriction you do place upon them, the more that they want to act out against that restriction?
Certainly psychology. I don't know about neuroscience. I don't know enough about it.
Well, maybe I did mean psychologically, sure.
Yeah,
sorry.
I mean, again, as a hypnotist, you know, like as a hypnotherapist, you're always trying to bypass the rational mind, to get around it. To show it the potentials, because people get very locked into their problems, you know. Where if people get up in the morning and think about all the horrible things that's going to happen, you can guarantee that when something happens, the part of their brain that will respond to it is the primitive emotional mind, which doesn't come up with solutions. It refers back to patterns. So we generate problems, we perpetuate problems by worrying about problems. That's not to say that we should completely forget about stuff. You know, as the Sufis say, trust in God, trust in Allah, but tie up your camel, you know. But once you tie up your camel, you know, shit happens, you know. Pain happens. There's no reason to think that we're put on this planet to be safe. No other animals are safe. The idea that we can be saved and looked after by a mega state corporate structure, whatever it is just an utter fallacy, you know. And it's a hard truth to learn. But, you know, when my kids fall over, when they were smaller, I didn't pick them up unless they were bleeding, unless there's something, because the world doesn't pick you up, you know. I actually believe that if you kind of half get up, then it does actually help you up. But if you just wait around. So that's what happened, you know, when I got ill, I was given the opportunity to take injections, which are kind of like the medical equivalent of airstrikes. Or I could do my very best to stimulate an indigenous resistance movement through my own immune system, through my own, you know, my gut flora, all that kind of stuff. And autonomy for me is on a level of individual in the health. It's on the level of the family. It's on the cognitive level, overcoming boundaries, overcoming rules. There's rules that are in place on what we're allowed to do. And there's also rules on how we think. Like you have divergent thinking and convergent thinking. Convergent thinking is the rule, is the categorizing and rule following part of the mind, which is governed by the temporal lobes. Interesting enough, there's no God there, as I'm reading the Bible, the God names, you know. So remember that line I came up with, was reading out before. Where is it? It says, "Out of the ground, Yahweh Elohim formed every beast of the air." And beast of the field and fowl of the air. So that's definition, that's Yahweh Elohim. And he brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. That's Adam coming up with the names. And whatever Adam called every living thing, that was the name thereof. So the name part of it, the categorization, the thing that's fixed, that's not governed by any power, that's governed by pure determinism, right? Once you've decided that that thing is a tree, it's a tree. You've got no power over that. As long as you're following the laws, there's no freedom to move.
Yeah. So there's a line in the book here. You wrote that philosophically, anarchy, and you separated that as a hyphenated word, anarchy. Philosophically, anarchy might reject any established principle, and then in parentheses, you wrote archon. And I didn't make I've never made that connection. Anarchy is, you're essentially rebelling against archonic control, and this concept of the archon, you know, comes from Gnosticism.
Well, the archon, exactly, it comes from Gnosticism. Also, the archae means, in archae is in the beginning, actually. In the beginning was the word, en arche en ho logos. That's what it is in Greek. Arche means beginning. It means apex. It means corner. It means principle, in principle, as in prime, the primary, the first, right? So the idea that, so in that line there, rejecting any established principle, is the primacy of something. So for example, let's think of a rule. You know, you shouldn't kill. Okay, well, probably most of the time you shouldn't kill, but kind of depends who you're killing, really. You know, you shouldn't steal. I mean, if all of the resources, if you're starving because all of the resources have been gobbled up and hidden away by the property owning class, should you not steal? I mean, I can't think of a single rule that applies in all cases. You know, even do unto others what you'd have done to yourself, you know.
Well, I was gonna say, what about something like rape, like sexual assault or something like that? Like, I don't know if there's any scenario where that would be acceptable.
Well, I mean, historically, it's been acceptable all over the place. I mean, look at what's going on with, I'm not saying it's right. There's certainly not a principle that seems to be followed. I'm not suggesting that people do, but yeah, it's a good point. But abuse is a matter of power structures. You know, people tend to abuse people when they have the power to. Any form of abuse, whether that's kind of racist killings by the police, or whether that's sexual abuse, or whether that's child abuse, you know, human beings are pretty nasty. You know, I deal with, again, in my job, I deal with people who suffer from abuse and the echoes going down over the years. I'm thinking of one particular case. There was a rapist in India who was tied up by tradition. There is, I think they call it a stick shower. Basically, the women tie him up and thrash him, right? I mean, that's a form of abuse, but looks pretty deserved, you know? So a particular action is always contextualized against something, I guess I put it there. I don't want to say anything stupid here. Yeah, of course, I'm not supporting rape or sexual abuse. But structurally, look at where we're at. You know, we live in massive structural patriarchal system of abuse.
Yeah, man, I didn't mean to put you on the spot there and force you to defend rape or sexual abuse, but I just, it was the first example that popped into my head of like, well, I don't know if there's any scenario where that's acceptable, but as you do say, and you know, when you read about the occult, when you read about, like, you're talking about power structures and ritual magic, alchemy, like, sex and sexual abuse plays a large role in that too. So it might not be acceptable to us now, but historically it's been popular, I guess, for lack of a better term.
Yeah, some people like being thrashed. I mean, even the golden rule, people tend to think that the golden rule, you know, do unto others as you'd have them do unto yourself. Well, I don't know. Some people like being sodomized. I'm not really down with it.
Yeah, I'm right there with you, man. But anyways, that's a great, I think, note to wrap up on, Danny.
Yeah, I think that's good as low as it can go.
for sure. And dude, this has been great. I appreciate you spending so much time here. Like I said, it's very late where you are, and you got an appointment in the morning, so I want to get you on out of here. Please do tell the audience where they can find more Reverend Nemu if they want in their lives.
You can find my website is nemusend.co.uk. That's www.nemusend.co.uk. That's got a load of stuff in it. Then what else have we got? Psychedelic Press. Look up those guys. My books are on there. There's also a bunch of other interesting authors on there, so check that out. If you're going to buy the books, that would be brilliant, but don't buy them off Amazon, because we get about 15p per copy or something like that. So if you get them off the website, we would really appreciate that. But yeah, go and check out the website.
Yeah, and shout out to Roz Stone at Psychedelic Press for hooking us up here. She's been a great facilitator of this conversation on the back end of it. So, and I'm very grateful that she introduced us, because this has been one of the better conversations I think I've had since this podcast started. So I really do appreciate your time, Danny. Love to talk to you again soon, man.
I tell you what, I appreciate two things. Firstly, reading the book, that's brilliant. And secondly, just asking really good questions. I got to talk and got to do some real thinking as well, which I haven't done for a little while on the podcast. So yeah, thank you. Much appreciated.
No problem, man. No problem. That's what I'm here for. So thanks again. And like I said, I'll be in touch. All right.
Cool. Good luck with the Philosopher's Stone.
Aha. Thank you so much. Thank you. You as well. Hell yes. My thanks again to the Reverend Danny Nemu. Nemusend.co.uk and Psychedelic Press are the places you want to be if you want more Neuro-Apocalypse in your life. Both of those are linked in the show notes. I also wrote a blog/book review of Neuro-Apocalypse. It's posted on the all-new OCCulturePodcast.com. I completely redesigned the site last week, and it is live, and I think it actually looks pretty good. Definitely a lot better than the old site, that's for sure. So if you haven't seen the new site yet, you know, maybe check out the blog I wrote about Danny's book. It's a good reason to click over to it. You know, one thing I mentioned in that blog is that Danny has been all over the place recently on various podcasts, and I did my best to make his appearance here a bit more unique. He is such a valuable resource for his biblical interpretations, which do focus a lot on drugs in the Bible. But when you're talking about that and psychedelics in general on other shows, and when you're like me and listen to all these other appearances anyway, I think it's important to offer you guys something just a bit different. And selfishly, I am far more interested in language and neuroscience than I am psychedelics, so I tried to pull that thread through here, and I hope you enjoyed it. Hey, if you did enjoy it, take a page out of Emma's playbook. She recently became our first patron on Patreon. If you're interested in showing us some love and having some love shown back, please do consider joining Emma and our other monthly supporters at patreon.com/oculture. Patrons get access to episodes before everyone else, exclusive bonus content, giveaways, opportunities to co-host with me, and much more. patreon.com/oculture. Of course, you can also support the show by leaving us a 5-star review or buying our first t-shirt at OCCulturePodcast.com/merch. That's all the gratuitous plugs I have for now. Oh wait, one more. We've got a hell of a Bitcoin episode coming up next, so hit that subscribe button and come back if you want a deep dive into some of the more occulted and esoteric aspects of this cryptocurrency. Until then, though, you've just been initiated into OCCulture. I am Ryan Peverly, reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority.
This cassette.